This week at the Internet Cafe, Wellness on the Web. This is the water birthing site where you can find out about natural ways to make childbirth a gentle, shared experience. Meet David Ornstein, a computer author who writes about global diseases. He's launched a website called Outbreak. This is a site called The Body. It's a rich source of information about HIV and AIDS. And meet John Lester. He's webmaster for the neurology department at Massachusetts General Hospital. Plus the iPhone, a new way to get online health care on a telephone. And free software, Health Matrix, an easy way to telnet to medical databases. And Neutrogeni, a program to monitor your diet, all coming up in our Cyber Blast. Wellness on the Web, next on the Internet Cafe.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One innovative idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the Internet. The connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor.
Hi, and welcome to the Internet Cafe. I'm Jane Wither, and this is Andrew deVries.
Hello.
And Stuart's not with us tonight. He's in Thailand, and I'm sure we'll hear about his escapades when he gets back next week.
And we miss him.
Yeah, very much so. Mm-hmm. And tonight we're going to talk about health. We're here at the CyberSmith Cafe in Palo Alto, California, the heart of Silicon Valley. And the topic is pretty varied. Who are some of the people you're talking to tonight?
Well, it's very varied, and it's also very global. I'm actually going to be talking to a group called The Body, and they've created a site that is really sort of the definitive AIDS, HIV site on the Internet. It has everything from, you know, chat areas where people can talk about things that are going on for them with HIV to all kinds of information sources. It's just an amazing site. And also on the global perspective, I'm talking to some group who created this site called Outbreak, and it's all about the Ebola virus and
wow.
how it's being tracked around the world, and it's pretty interesting, a little scary too.
Yeah, well, on the slightly different topic, not on the infectious disease side, but on the issue of childbirth, one of the people I'm talking to is about water birthing.
Not on the Internet,
Mm-mm,
I hope.
Actually, okay. It's pictures on the Internet of people having babies
wow.
under the water.
A new way to have children.
Really, it's actually pretty interesting, so that should be neat. And then I'm also going to talk to a gentleman from Massachusetts General Hospital and talk about some of the websites that they have that talk about neurological disorders. So if you have a neurological disorder like multiple sclerosis, for example, or Tourette's syndrome, or if you're a caregiver, you can get more information about that as well. So
it sounds like some good topics.
Absolutely.
Tonight, it's Health on the Internet Cafe. So Jamie, you have created a site on the web called The Body, and I think it's one of the most powerful and comprehensive sites I've seen around a really powerful and scary issue of HIV and AIDS. And I'm wondering how you got started.
Thanks, Andrew. We're really excited about it. I was a civil rights lawyer, and in that work I learned the power of community. If a community comes together around an issue, it can make a change. And that's what we're trying to do on the Internet with HIV/AIDS. This tool allows people to come together who've never come together before and share their health concerns, share their small triumphs, their deepest fears, and tackle the disease much more effectively.
Right, and I saw that. Last night I was, you know, up on the site, and I went into this first section of connecting to other people, and the ability to go in and really see stories of people posted on there, see actually photo essays was really powerful. What's going on in that section that really is making a difference?
These are amazing stories that people share, and it can be caring for another, it can be their own experience with treatment. The idea is to give people a model, visitors a model of what their experience could be like, and to give them courage
right.
to take the next step.
Right, and I saw that. There was people I related to, people my age, people with similar backgrounds, you know, that were going through something that was hard to imagine, but I saw that and I felt, you know, compassion and I felt empathy and concern. The other thing that I thought was really interesting was the section that deals with having experts, you know, in many different fields, in medicine, in sports, in politics, advocacy, things like that, that people can ask questions to and they'll respond. The Johns Hopkins University, I mean, who is that person and what are they doing there?
He is sensational. His name is Joel Gallant, and besides running maybe the top AIDS clinic in America...
And he's an MD, right?
He's an MD.
Yes.
He's on our site answering dozens of questions
right.
a week.
Amazing, and I mean complicated questions, questions about some of the new, you know, AIDS and HIV drugs and all kinds of things. How do they find time to do that?
This is a great way for people who need to know these answers to sign on and find out.
Right.
The information is changing almost every month, and how do you keep up with it when you have a very limited time with your own doctor,
right,
and it's a complex decision to make? If you have an expert online, you can find out the answer you need.
Right, and that was a really, you know, I'm wondering a little bit about the liability issues around some of that stuff, but I think it was just powerful, powerful. I also saw an HIV-positive marathon runner on there who was also talking to people, and I found that so inspirational to be able to, you know, see someone who has a life-threatening disease and says, I'm not going to change my dreams, my goals, they're still here, and go out and do that. I'm wondering, you know, from an outreach standpoint, there's other organizations that I saw on the site as well. And what do you do with those
types of things?
We work
with more than 30 of America's top teaching hospitals, AIDS organizations, professional medical societies.
So you're synthesizing their information.
That's right. We have a vast library that has come together from all of them, and we make it easy to search, and we catalog things so that if you don't know the name of a class of drugs or a particular opportunistic infection, you can still find it on the site.
Okay, interesting. Now, for the future, you know, you talked about building community and maybe building community around a disease, around prevention. What's the future gonna hold for the body?
That's really the goal. The idea of the power that comes when all these issues are brought together in one place,
right,
that this community can transform the way HIV/AIDS is addressed in America and the world.
The world, right. Well, great. Thank you very much, Jamie.
So, Carol, what prompted you to have the water birth site?
Well, you know, I had made a video film about water birth that a lot of people love, and I decided that I wanted to get direct information to women who are interested and to birth care professionals who are interested. So I put up this site so that a lot more people could access the information, because I think it's really important to get this information out. It is amazing how gentle and empowering birth can be when it's not filled with pain and stress for the mother and the baby. And that's what water birth does. That's why I'm so excited about it. So I wanted to get this information direct to people.
So what kind of information would I find at the water birth site?
Well, there's lots of photos. We have a photo gallery, which is great. And you can actually see what it looks like. And we have information about water birth itself. Why? Where does it come from? How does it work? Who's doing it? Who are the experts? What's the benefits?
So why would you recommend a water birth over a normal birth?
Well, it alleviates the pain and stress of childbirth for the mother and for the baby. And it allows the mother to really be in control of the birth and to really take the power of bringing a new life into the world and really integrate it in a way that is non-stressful, so the mother and the baby can really enjoy it.
So maybe it's important that we take a step back and maybe just explain what a water birth is, because it is quite a bit different.
Well, the baby actually comes into a water environment. The mom is in the tub, often chest high in water, and the baby comes from one warm liquid environment inside the mother's body into another warm liquid environment. So what could be less stressful, more comfortable for the baby and for the mother, because you know what a warm bath feels like. It's just, oh, you know.
So now that must be fairly controversial. I mean, I don't think that most hospitals have adopted the concept of water
birth. Not most yet, but it's starting.
But
to
it
change.
Is moving along.
Yes, in the last 3 months, I have noticed a major interest on the part of many hospitals, and it is moving into the hospitals. It really is, and that's exciting because over 90% of women give birth in the hospital, so we have to get the hospitals on board here.
Absolutely. Now, what are some other sites that you'd recommend for a woman who's interested in water birth or any other type of other options that they might have?
My site links to several water birth stories of moms that have had water births and tell their own personal birth stories. That's one thing that I love, the birth stories. There's a question and answer section site with Dr. Rosenthal, who's one of the pioneers of water birth, and we link to his question and answer site about water birth. There's a lot of parenting links. And then there's one site that I haven't actually linked to because it's off topic, but I love it because it's the other side. If you want to have a baby, come to the water birth site. But if you don't want a baby, if you want to know what your birth control options are, there's a wonderful site about birth control options that talks about all the various different kinds, including the female condom, which is very interesting and, again, puts more control in the hands of the women. And explains all the different options of what you can use and how good it is. It's a very complete site and it's very interesting.
So I think that's one of the fascinating things is that now you have the ability through the web to actually get information about things that probably going to your local doctor, you might not be able to readily access some of these other options.
Absolutely. There is so much direct person-to-person contact in terms of being able to research out topics of what you want. And I love the fact that it's direct and there's no distributors in the way, there's no
straight
agents.
To you.
Yeah, it's information and user, direct connection. I love that.
Thanks a lot, Carol.
Thank you.
So, David, you are a little bit of an oxymoron, if you will. I mean, someone who's a software designer, and you've created a site that seems to be one of the sort of the definitive sites on emerging and re-emerging diseases. How did you create the outbreak site, and what was your motivation behind it?
Well, the internet is supposed to be a source of information about almost everything you want to know, and there wasn't anything about this stuff on the internet, so I dug in and made some of it.
And it was something that interests you? I mean, this was a topic that you...
Pretty much any subject interests me, and it just happened to be something that grabbed me, and I dug in. And,
was it the movies, the books that were out on the subject?
No, it was actually before that. I think it's just the kind of Ebola in particular was what really got me started,
right.
And that's just, it grabs you, you know,
right.
The idea, I mean, some of the imagery in the media has been a little bit outlandish, but it still grabs you,
right.
You know, the idea of your organs melting and all this kind of stuff, it's an exaggeration, but it still grabs
right.
you.
Right, and I think it's interesting because you've taken what has been sort of an overblown subject and created a really grounded and very well-focused site on the subject. What are some of the ways you've collected that information and presented it to people?
Uh-huh. Well, a lot of it has been organizing a kind of volunteer team of people who are sort of similarly interested
mm-hmm.
and getting them together with professionals who participate as a kind of review committee. So we do some of our own research, we get reports from the news media, we scan that stuff and kind of collate and write,
and
you know,
put it up there. So you have people all over the world who are looking for information,
information? We have sort of volunteer editors and also volunteer news searchers, and we have these people who are just kind of out there proactively searching for
looking
what's going
for
on in their areas.
What I thought was interesting on your site, speaking of gathering this information, is that you actually seem like you have a system in place of talking to people about, you know, the validity of the information you put up on the site, saying that some of it is, you know, from traditional solid
right.
news sources
right.
and some of it may be from more maybe less reputable or tested.
Yeah, it's there are many, you know, if you look at peer-reviewed journals, right, they wait a year to get the material in there. It's solid once it gets in there, but sometimes it's late, and especially with this kind of stuff, you don't want to be late.
Right.
So we mark things with, you know, we just got this, we don't know where it's from, but it's important enough to get it out there.
Right.
You know, so we have these kind of quality indicators on the information.
Right. So what are some of the hot news items that are going on right now in the world of Ebola and diseases such as that?
God, well, you know, there's a whole slew of things. There was, I think one of the most interesting things was there was Ebola in South Africa just a couple of months ago.
Mm.
There was a doctor who got sick in Gabon, and he just got on a commercial airliner and flew to South Africa. And,
really? And
yeah,
took the illness with him?
Yeah, he got a nurse sick there, and
really?
She died, and it was... It's a pretty scary present stuff. You know, it's only an airplane ride away. I mean, I don't want to be sensational, but it really is.
It can spread that quickly. So you, in a sense, gather information, stories like that, or folks who are with you, you put that up as fast as you can, and it becomes a tracking source?
In fact, her brother lives in Australia, and I got an email message from him saying that we were his source of information about her condition before she died. It was pretty heavy.
Very. Well, not to over-centralize it a little more, but what are some of the, you know, the scariest issues right now facing sort of emerging or re-emerging diseases?
I think the scariest issue is that there's still a sense that we've conquered diseases, and it's, you know,
and it's not true.
It's not true at all.
So where do you see your site going as a way to maybe aid that, or at least
join the
fight?
Well, the idea is to educate people to the situation, and to, you know, we haven't licked, you know, we thought we licked all of these things, thought we were going to lick malaria, thought we were going to lick all these diseases, and it's actually heading in the other direction.
Still with us, and you can read about them on the Outbreak site.
Yep.
Well, thank you very much.
Sure.
On this week's Cyber Blast, we're going to send you 5 programs, a black bag full of software to work on your health and well-being. Altogether, this will be more than 4 megabytes of data, and the download will take less than 115 seconds. This is actually what the data looks like as it comes in through your TV signal. To get these files to your computer this fast through your TV set, you need a card for your computer called a TV modem. This lets you do these quick downloads without a phone line. You can download these files off the internet with your regular telephone modem. Download time from the net at 28.8 will be about half an hour. Let me tell you what we're sending you. First of all, Health Matrix. This is a very useful tool that helps you telnet to various medical libraries and databases, including medical newsletters and journals. Next, a program called MedInsure Magic. If you have to deal with the hassle of keeping track of medical costs for insurance reimbursement purposes, this is a handy program that makes it easy to record medical visits, services, and costs. Then a program called Neutrogeni. This is a very simple Windows program that helps you keep track of the amount of fat, cholesterol, and sodium in your diet. Now your computer can also get sick, so we're sending you McAfee's virus scan for Windows 95 to keep your hard drive clean and healthy. Finally, for your mental health and stress reduction, we're sending you some screensavers that are designed to calm you down. The file is called Psych35. Remember, we're sending all 5 files to you through the TV signal, over 4 megabytes of data in under 2 minutes, using our CyberBlast technology. That's about 15 times faster than with a typical telephone modem. If you need information on how to receive a CyberBlast or on how to get a TV modem, just check out the Internet Cafe section of our website at pctv.com. You'll also find information there on how to download these files directly from the net. So the download is just about complete. Have fun with your new software. That wraps up this Cyber Blast on the Internet Cafe. I'm Laurie Anderson. So John, you manage a number of websites that deal with the issue of neurological disorders, and you do that for the Massachusetts General Hospital and also Harvard University. Mm-hmm. What are some of the websites that you actually manage?
Well, probably the most popular one is Hospital Web, which is a simple index of all hospitals on the World Wide Web. It's a simple index list. And I also run a website for, a general website for the Department of Neurology, information about our department. But I also do a number of websites for patients and caregivers, trying to supply them with information about the different neurological disorders they have.
So one of the websites that you had was for Tourette's syndrome. Mm-hmm. And I thought was interesting was that, in fact, the Tourette's Syndrome Society did not have access to the internet, did not use the website to post information about it. You actually approached them and made them aware of the ability to be able to post their information.
Yes, it is.
And now this, you've got this great website where people can get information about this disease and actually get some information about frequently asked questions or frequent assumptions that we make about that particular syndrome. Mm-hmm. Now, there was another one, and I think you said it, Gaucher disease. Now, what's that all about?
That's a very rare genetic disorder. Only about 1 in 40,000 people have it. There's no cure. And we have a treatment center in our hospital, in our Department of Neurology, for Gaucher disease. And I basically just put information online about the disorder, also information for clinicians as well, to sort of educate doctors about the disorder. And it's become a central place for people to find out information about Gaucher disease and also where the closest treatment center is for them. Because it being a rare disorder, it's not common knowledge.
So what about sharing information? If I have a disorder and I want to talk to people who have a similar issue,
Do you have a website where they can, you know, share information, like a bulletin board or?
Yeah, I run the neurology web forums. They've been going for a couple years now, and they're organized by neurological disorder, ranging from something very rare like Gaucher disease to something common like multiple sclerosis. And people can post questions and answers and just have discussions amongst themselves in an open forum. They can be anonymous if they want, so they don't have to give up any of their privacy. And it's a really wonderful place for people to share experiences, because I think a lot of what helps people deal with different neurological disorders is to communicate with other people who have similar situations.
So they can share those experiences.
Yeah.
I think that's a big part, especially with neurological disorders, because I think there's a lot of misunderstandings about mm-hmm. why people behave or why people have, you know, why they manifest behaviors in a certain way. Mm-hmm. Now, what about, I think what was interesting is there was this one area that you had, and I think it was a window into my mind, is that what it's called?
The poetry site.
Yeah. Now tell me a little bit about that, because there must be a story behind that.
Well, that started because someone made a post on the web forum, a poem, basically, that they were trying to express what it was like to have a seizure. This person has epilepsy, and they were trying to be creative about what it was like to go through a seizure and what it was like dealing with people seeing you have a seizure. And I thought that was really fascinating, and the poem was beautiful, and I was also fascinated with the whole idea of expressing yourself that way. And so I created a separate site called A Window on My Mind, which is only poetry, and it's organized by neurological disorder, so you can write a poem about what it's like to maybe have a seizure, or maybe have it be a caregiver for someone with Alzheimer's disease or Huntington's disease. And I think it's another way to creatively express your feelings about these different disorders, because sometimes you can't do it in normal speech.
Simple words don't.
No, and particularly with neurological disorders, where a lot of it changes the way you perceive things, and sometimes these neurodegenerative disorders like Alzheimer's disease and Huntington's disease, there's a lot of emotion. You know, if you have a family member who's suffering from Alzheimer's.
And it's interesting that a lot of the poetry is actually done by the caregivers. It's a way that they can express how they feel about dealing with this particular disorder with somebody that they love.
Exactly.
It's a phenomenal website. Thanks very much, John.
Sure. You're welcome.
So, Ron, you're from Medical Telecommunications Associates, and you've invented this pretty cool-looking device here.
Well, actually, we found it. Infogear created it. Citgo is manufacturing it, and we at Medical Telecommunications Associates call this a medical telecommunications device.
Okay. Tell me how this is going to help my health care at home.
Well, hopefully, households are going to more readily adapt to an internet phone. And I don't want to wait for every household to have a PC, a modem, and an ISP that takes them
somewhere. So this is a way to get the internet and a telephone all kind of in one, and have link-ups to various information around the world. Now, is this going to have link-ups to doctor's offices, to medical facilities?
Absolutely. This provides the connectivity between a patient at home and a doctor in his or her office.
Now, how would that actually work? This looks like a keypad. I mean, am I going to type in I'm feeling ill, or?
For email, but actually a form will come up on the page appropriately, and a health risk assessment will be done. Let's say you have an asthmatic child in your home.
Right.
A whole bunch of questions can be asked about your asthmatic child, and that could be sent off to your physician's office.
Wow.
Rather than you're bundling your kid on a cold day and going into the office with your kid wheezing.
And maybe even get a response back, whether it's serious or not. Now, what about actual, will there be some sort of input devices? Can I get my blood pressure taken or things
today
like that?
Today there are digital cups or sphygmomanometers, and they read, and there will be a serial port on this internet phone so that readings can be sent out of your home to the concerned physician's office.
As well, so it'll be monitoring things that way. Now, how about as far as accessing any information from the web on healthcare? Is that something as well?
Your physician mm-hmm. will have selected those sites he would like for you to go to, kind of with his imprimatur, because you trust your physician, and he will have customized for you, depending upon your condition, the websites he'd like you to explore.
That's great, Ron. It's a definite twist on an HMO. I'm looking forward to it. Thank you.
Good.
So I think we really covered the spectrum tonight
of
some healthcare issues, and I thought there was some really interesting and some really touching things as well. What were some of the things that really sort of stood out for you?
Well, I think just the fact that there's a vehicle for people with, you know, very rare disorders that they can talk to one another about it, or not so rare disorders,
right,
like HIV, and they can talk about their feelings and talk about what that experience is to them. I mean, typically in health, or in any health-related issue, you're going to have a one-on-one conversation with your doctor.
Mm-hmm.
It's generally a really short conversation. Mm-hmm. And now this internet vehicle is this forum for you to talk to people with common interests, common problems,
right,
and share those experiences and hopefully gain some insight about what it is you're dealing with or what your family's dealing,
right,
with.
Right. And not just insight, but I think inspiration as
absolutely
well. One of the things that I saw as I was reading through the body of the HIV site was the messages that people were putting up there about once they realized they had a serious disease, an infectious disease, and that their life was potentially going to be shorter, that they were able to, in a sense, begin living their life.
Exactly.
You know, it was like one day at a time, every day became a special thing. There was a post on there from an HIV positive marathon runner who, you know, decided that he was not going to give up, and this made his dreams and his goals even more important, and he kept going. So I feel like those kind of things were very important.
Yeah.
And amazing to see.
That's the exciting thing about this vehicle, this internet, to be able to talk about those topics.
Right.
So join us for another show at the Internet Cafe next week.
The Internet Cafe is made possible in part by Intel. One innovative idea always leads to another. Now there are connected CD-ROMs that link rich multimedia with related information on the Internet. The connected CD-ROMs, it's the Intel Pentium processor.